Entering Bovard Auditorium from your left and right are the members of the Platform Party, including University Directors of Religious Life and Student Leaders, the Academic Deans, the Senior Officers of the University, the Trustees, our 2023 Honorary Degree Recipients, our Baccalaureate Speaker, Rick Caruso, and President Carol Folt. The columns are led by Dr. Dan Pecanino, President of the Faculty who carries the University Mace, and Dr. Donald Manahan, University Marshal. Seated, and welcome our Dean of Religious and Spiritual Life, Varun Soni.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Varun Soni. I'm the Dean of Religious and Spiritual Life here at the University of Southern California. On behalf of the Office of Religious and Spiritual Life, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to our annual baccalaureate ceremony. How are you all doing this evening? Yeah? Are you fired up? Fired up? You ready to go? Great. Well, Baccalaureate 2023 is a multi-faith, multicultural celebration representing a significant aspect of USC's 140th commencement exercises. The world's great universities arose from a religious context, and it is altogether fitting to underscore the spiritual, moral, and cultural dimensions of our educational mission as we come together to celebrate commencement. And it is also auspicious to host our baccalaureate ceremony right here in this historic auditorium named after Marion Bovard, who not only served as the first president of the University of Southern California, but also as the first pastor of the University Methodist Episcopal Church. This evening, we are honored to have with us as part of the Platform Party, the president and the provost of the University of Southern California, who are joined by members of the Board of Trustees. Also on this platform this evening are our keynote baccalaureate and student speakers. Our student valedictorian and salutatorians are also with us, as are recipients of honorary degrees at tomorrow's commencement. The president of the faculty who led the processional carrying the mace is here, as are the university marshal and the president of the staff assembly. We also have with us religious directors from many student groups, our academic deans, associates of the provost's office, and a number of senior university administrators. Graduating students representing our diverse religious and cultural groups are on stage and in the audience this evening, and many of their group banners hang overhead. Here at the University of Southern California, we have more student religious groups and more campus chaplains than any other American university. And we reside right in the heart of Los Angeles, the City of Angels, the most religiously diverse city in human history. So as you can imagine, we have unparalleled opportunities here for interfaith engagement and interreligious understanding. Perhaps no image better represents the religious pluralism and spiritual promise of our campus and of our city than that of the palm tree, such as the one beautifully depicted in exquisite stained glass at the Our Savior Church of the USC Caruso Catholic Center. For Christians, the palm is a biblical symbol of royalty and of righteousness. Indeed, the Bible assures us that the righteous will flourish like the palm tree, yielding fruit, remaining vigorous and fresh. And throughout Christian scripture and history, the palm designates victory and good news. In Jewish culture, the palm has long been associated with rejoicing and celebration. For Muslims, the palm represents the highest virtues of hospitality and community. Members of the Baha'i faith connect the palm to peace and prosperity, and for the Dharma traditions of Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and Sikhism, the palm signifies knowledge that has been preserved through time on palm leaf manuscripts. Palmum qui meritat firat. Let whoever earns the palm bear it. So stands the official motto of the University of Southern California, boldly inscribed on the university seal and elegantly embossed on the diplomas that will be conferred during tomorrow's commencement ceremony. And so, the palm is a sacred symbol of achievement and celebration for us as a Trojan family, just as it is for all the world's great religions. To the new graduates of the University of Southern California, now that you have completed your degrees here, you have finally achieved the lofty aspiration of our university's motto. You have truly earned the palm. Earning the palm means that you've been in school for your entire conscious life. I don't have to tell you that. Over that time, you've taken thousands of exams, written hundreds of papers, and received dozens of course grades, and you've excelled at the very highest level throughout all of it. You've been awarded prestigious scholarships and internship opportunities. You've mastered musical instruments and played competitive sports. You've learned different languages and traveled the world, and you've led student organizations and philanthropic efforts. Indeed, in order to earn the palm, you jumped through every hoop, traversed every obstacle, avoided every pitfall, and moved every mountain. And you did all of this in the midst of a once-in-a-century global pandemic. Let whoever earns the palm bear it. By doing everything that your family and university dreamt for you, and by achieving all the metrics of success that the world set for you, you have truly earned the palm, but what does it now mean to bear it? I think what it means is that after fulfilling dreams and achieving success as defined by others, you can now finally and honestly ask and answer an urgent and existential question: what is your dream? And what does success mean for you? Over the last several months, you have been compiling a stellar resume, an important document for the world to see that highlights all of your extraordinary academic, artistic, athletic, and leadership success. This professional resume chronicles your professional life and features an impressive list of skills and accomplishments that tell a story about how you earned the palm. But at the same time, as you write your professional resume, you should also keep another document that only you see, your personal resume, that tells a different story, a story about how you bear the palm. And that story should celebrate your courage, your creativity, your relationships, your purpose, your passion, and even your failures, all the things that make you personally successful. Whereas your professional resume focuses on things that you can't always control, your personal resume should focus on things you can always control, the things that are powerful beyond measure, the most important things in your life. What can you control? Well, you can control your beliefs, your attitude, your thoughts, your perspectives, your values. You can control how honest you are, who your friends are, who your superheroes are. I'm talking about Marvel, not DC. You can control what books you read, how you commune with nature, what you eat, how you interpret situations. You can control how many risks you take, how much time you spend on TikTok. Actually, I think the algorithm controls that. But you can control how kind you are, how grateful you are, how much effort you exert, how much time you spend worrying or not worrying, how you judge or don't judge others. You can control how many times you say, "I love you." And most importantly, you can control how much joy you put out into the world and how much joy you accept back from the world. Tomorrow, you will walk across the commencement stage to receive your long-anticipated degree. As you do so, you will feel the full range of human emotion throughout the day. In the morning, you will feel elation, relief, pride, and for some of you, inebriation. You know who you are. I'm talking to the parents out there too. The 9-0 opens really early tomorrow, but it's commencement, not a tailgate. Remember that. You put the flasks away. But I digress. By the evening, when you start to say goodbye to the best friends you've ever had, the day will begin to feel bittersweet, infused with pangs of sadness, confusion, longing, and regret. As you experience this roller coaster ride of emotions tomorrow at commencement, may you also find a moment to honor and embrace and embody joy. May you feel inspired to write your personal resume and empowered to live out your own version of success. May you continue to flourish like the palm so that you draw and sustain nourishment even during dry seasons. And may we all say together, amen.
This, our beloved campus, represents what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. calls the beloved community of love and justice. And in the beauty of our humanity and the uniqueness of our individual life experience, we gather to pray. We have already prayed for this beloved campus. Every time we went to a football game, every time we sat in Zoom class, every time we walked across Truesdale or went to Starbucks, our time spent on this campus is a prayer. And so now I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we continue to pray for this, our beloved home. And I invite you to join me in this prayer, which can be found inside of your program. And let us recite together. Eternal One, the source of life and light for all people, we pray that you endow the University of Southern California with your grace and wisdom. Give insight and devotion to those who teach, understanding and diligence to those who learn. Grant vision to the university's trustees and administrators, and a spirit of mutuality to all whose work is here. May the ideal of being a Trojan family be fulfilled as we care for one another, enrich the traditions that we have inherited, and pass them on through the chain of generations. To all who bear like a palm the university's proud name, convey your guiding spirit of truth and service. And let us say, amen. You may be seated.
The Office of Religious and Spiritual Life at USC is nurtured by dozens of student leaders and religious directors, many of whom are seated at the back of our stage this evening. From Suraj Raja and Abhilash Kulkarni of the Hindu Student Org, to Stephen Kim and Suhas Pila of the Interfaith Joy Community, members of Hillel, Chabad, the Caruso Catholic Center, the Vedanta Hollywood Temple, and the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And of course, everyone else is on stage, including Noah Saeed and Alexis Escamilla, longtime student staffers of the Office of Religious and Spiritual Life. So give it up. It gives me great pleasure to be joined by three of our student leaders now who will offer sacred readings from various traditions, Judaism, Sikhism, and Hinduism. So I leave it to them to pray us in.
The following verse is from Rabbi Sherwin Wein of the humanistic Jewish tradition. Hope is a choice, never found, never given, always taken. Some wait for hope to capture them. They act as the prisoners of despair. Others go search for hope. They find nothing but the reflection of their own anger. Hope is an act of will, affirming in the presence of evil that good things will happen, preferring in the face of failure self-esteem to pity. Optimists laugh, even in the dark. They know hope is a lifestyle, not a guarantee. I believe in hope. I believe in hope that chooses self-respect above pity. I believe in hope that feels distant pleasure as much as momentary pain. I believe in hope that acts without the guarantee of success. I believe in hope that kisses the future with the transforming power of its will. Thank you.
The following Shabad, or hymn, is from the sixth sacred scripture, the Shri Guru Granth Sahib, and it's offered as an ardas for all living creatures on this planet, ardas being prayer. First, I will sing the Shabad, or hymn, in the sixth sacred form of music, Gurmat Sangeet, and then I will read the text in English.
ਸਲੋਕ ਮਹੱਲਾ ਪੰਜਵਾਂ ਸਭੇ ਜੀ ਸਮਾਏ ਆਪਣੀ ਮਿਹਰ ਕਰ ਅਨਪਾਣੀ ਮੁੱਚ ਉਪਾਏ ਦੁੱਖ ਦਾ ਲਰਦ ਪੰਨ ਤਰ ਅਰਦਾਸ ਸੁਣੀ ਦਾਰ ਹੋਈ ਸਟ ਠਰ ਲੇਵੋ ਕੰਠ ਲਗਾਏ ਅਪਦਾ ਸਭ ਹਰ ਨਾਨਕ ਨਾਮ ਤੇ ਆਏ
In your mercy, you care for all beings and creatures. You produce food and water in abundance. You eliminate pain and poverty and carry all beings across. God has listened to my prayer and blessed us with tranquility and calmness. Take me into your embrace and take away all my pain. Thank you.
Today I'll be chanting an ancient Hindu Manojavam mantra, Ganesh Gayatri mantra, and Vakratunda Ganesh mantra. These mantras are very special to my family, woven of strong women, passed down from my dear Pati, and that's my grandmother, and our ancient ancestors. Lord Hanuman brings positivity, hope, and strength. Lord Ganesha grants success, prosperity, and protection against all obstacles as we enter this new chapter of our lives. I'll recite the shlokas both in traditional Sanskrit and then translate them into English. Manojavam maruta tulya vegam jitendriyam buddhimatam varishtam vatatmajam vanara yuta mukyam shri ramadutam sharanam prapadye om ekadantaya vidyamahe vakratundaya dimahi tano danti prachodayat vakratunda mahakaye suryakoti samaprabaha Nirvignyam Guru Medeva Sarva Karyeshu Sarvada Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.
Let me pray and salute to the one who is swift as thought, the one who is more powerful than the wind, the one who has conquered his senses, best amongst the wise, the son of the wind god, commander of the army of forest creatures. To that, Lord Sri Rama's messenger, the incomparable Lord Hanuman, let me seek refuge. We meditate upon and pray for greater intellect to the Lord with the curved elephant-shaped trunk. We bow before the one with the single-tusked elephant tooth to illuminate our minds with wisdom. O God with curved trunk, large body whose aura is like the crores of sun, please make my entire work obstacle-free. Forever. Thank you.
read my mind, I'm undefined. I'm just beginning, the pen's in my hand, ending unplanned. Staring at the blank page before you, open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you cannot find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you can always taste it. Release your inhibition, feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else, no one else can speak the words on your lips. Drench yourself in words unspoken, live your life with arms wide open. Today is where your book begins, the rest is still unwritten. Tradition. Sometimes my tries are outside the lines. We've been conditioned to not make mistakes, but I can't live that way. Staring at the blank page before you, open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you cannot find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you can almost taste it. Release your inhibition, feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else, no one else can speak the words on your lips. Drench yourself in words unspoken, live your life with arms wide open. Today is where your book begins, the rest is still unwritten. Staring at the blank page before you, open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you cannot find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you can almost taste it. Release your inhibition and feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else, no one else can speak the words on your lips. Drench yourself in words unspoken, live your life with arms wide open. Today is where your book begins. Still unwritten. The rest is still unwritten.
Can we hear it again for Aspen Jacobson? Our undergraduate students are not the only ones who have completed their senior year at USC this year. So did our university president, Dr. Carol Fult, who just finished her fourth year here, and so we're celebrating her graduation today too. Just 4 years ago, when President Fult arrived on campus with many of the graduating students here today, she inherited an ambitious university that had sadly lost its way. We were mired in constant scandal and self-generated crises, and as a result, we greatly suffered from a serious loss of trust and hope on campus. It was a very painful and difficult time for our Trojan family, and I think it's safe to say that we were all desperate for a path to redemption. In the 4 years since she's been here, Dr. Fult has courageously taken us on a culture journey and challenged us to think deeply about our values and about our ethics. In doing so, she started to build trust back on campus. And with that trust, she has boldly transformed this university, bringing it from the darkness back into the light in just 4 short years. Indeed, since she's been here, Dr. Fult made USC tuition-free for families making less than $80,000 per year. This is a big deal. We talk a lot about equity, but this is what it actually looks like. She halted university investment in fossil fuels and liquidated current holdings in our investment portfolio and endowment, which I think makes USC the largest university in the nation to do so. I got a lot of these, so maybe we should just wait till the end, or we'll be here all night. She banned single-use plastics from campus and put us on an aggressive course to be a carbon-neutral university producing zero waste by 2028. She opened a campus building in Washington, D.C., our new Trojan embassy, to place USC at the center of political policy and advocacy. She announced the creation of a new school at USC, the School of Advanced Computing, as part of a larger $1 billion initiative on campus focused on frontiers of computing. She doubled the number of mental health counselors on campus and dramatically expanded student cultural centers. She convened and led the university's first ever advisory committees on Jewish life and Muslim life. She renamed spaces and places on campus to honor Trojans who represent our highest ideals and aspirations. She presided over the most selective admissions class in USC's history. For the first time, less than 10% of the applicants who applied to USC were admitted, and so for all you alums out there, your degree is worth more every year. And I gotta say, she pretty much ushered in a new golden era of Trojan athletics. How nice was it to see the Coliseum full again after so many empty and lonely years? And to have the Heisman Trophy finally return home again. And it's only gonna get better and bigger as we move into the Big Ten. If sports are a religion, then she truly is the chief evangelist for the religion of Troy. Dr. Folt somehow managed to do all of this with the unprecedented challenges of physical dislocation and remote learning while overseeing a medical center on the front line of a global pandemic and wrestling with a university budget with over $1 billion in unanticipated COVID expenses. In the age of constant outrage and online trolling, I find that being a leader is really, really hard and totally thankless. And so I want to take this time to thank you, Dr. Folt, for your extraordinary courage and for your moral leadership, for your strength of conviction and for your open heart, for always keeping our students front and center as your true north, and for convening us for this celebration of baccalaureate at a time when we need it most. Dr. Folt is a highly experienced leader, internationally recognized life scientist, and award-winning teacher. Formerly, she was the chancellor of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, which is the nation's oldest public university. She also served as interim president and provost of Dartmouth College. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to our esteemed leader, the 12th president of the University of Southern California, who has just completed her senior year, Dr. Carol Folt.
Oh my, yikes. Thank you, Dean Soni. And of course, what you heard were all the things that we've all been doing together for 4 years, but unlike these really smart students, I don't get to graduate. Or maybe I'm just smarter than all they are because I get to stay. I just wanna say greetings to all the graduating Trojans, families, friends. As you can see, baccalaureate is a very, very special time. It's a chance for us to gather right on the eve of commencement, and we get to talk and think about things that allow us to reflect and think about things in a more spiritual and reflective way about all the things that our students and our faculty, staff, families have been experiencing during these past 4 years. I have a very special place in my heart for the class of 2023, no doubt, because we started this USC journey in 2019 together. When we think back, I don't think any of us could have ever predicted what was ahead, but we were forced to pivot, to persevere, and practice a lot of patience. And here we are at graduation, anticipating what comes next. And you know, it's okay if you know what's coming next, but it's absolutely okay if you don't. In fact, you probably really don't. It's all ready to change. But the opportunities that come to all of us really mean a lot and come better when we're able to reflect on where we are. And as you heard Dean Soni say, ask yourself about really where you do want to be. It's all your choice now. Regardless of where our students and our graduates are in their life story, my wish for all of them is that they do find joy and meaning in life. I want to see you find joy in your work, in your community, find meaning in very small things as well as the big things. And it isn't always easy to do. We've certainly seen that. Yet I really do believe that when our students think back and they see all that they've learned in the last 4 years, they will be anticipating and realizing that life will become demanding. I think thinking about what the world is like right now and how you learn to handle it and how you learn to think your way through it and feel your way through it. I made a choice just last week. This is really true. I decided to take those incessant, annoying breaking news alerts off my phone. It's a good thing. You know, it was really, it disrupts your every chain of thought. It is vitally important to stay abreast of world affairs and the things that are happening. And our social science and journalism students are going to make sure that we really do that. But sometimes you have to choose your own breaking news. You need to find ways throughout your life to lessen the noise and the interruptions so that you can hear your own thoughts. There was a beautiful article recently in the New York Times, and it has the concept of our many possible selves. And it asks, who do you want to become? Who do you think you can become? And I love these words by the poet Nayira Wayudi. And they are I'm going to read a little bit of that poem. You are a sea of light. Open your eyes. See yourself. When I look out at our students tomorrow, I am going to see that incredible sea of light. Their faces radiant, beaming with joy, and I think we're all going to celebrate. Steven Spielberg, the legendary filmmaker and former USC trustee, reminds us, the past may dictate who we are, but we get to determine what we become. This December marks the 30th anniversary of his seminal film, Schindler's List. And that film shows us what that one person's action can make a profound difference in their lives of many others. Stephen was so inspired when he made that film by all the Holocaust survivors that he met that he established the Shoah Foundation, which is housed right here at USC. And it's home to more than 50,000 first-person testimonies, which are preserved for all humankind. It's beautiful. USC awards Stephen an honorary degree in 1994, and he joined a list of luminaries that date back to 1912. Tomorrow we have three incredibly inspirational individuals who'll be joining this group. Frances Arnold, the first American woman to win the Nobel Prize in chemistry. She and her students got around every roadblock imaginable to change the face of chemistry. We're also honoring, or being honored by, I would say, Dolores Huerta, the social justice activist. She taught us, si se pueda, meaning, of course, yes, we can, yes, it's possible. She got her community literally around every kind of roadblock possible, giving her full heart to improving human rights. And our commencement speaker, Kevin Feige, president of Marvel Studios and the force behind movies like Black Panther, Guardians of the Galaxy, Shang-Chi, The Legend of the Ten Rings. He has worked tirelessly to increase representation across media, both in front of and behind the camera. And Kevin is a School of Cinematics Arts alum. Dolores is a parent of two USC alums. So both Dolores and Kevin are with us tonight. So great. So thank you, and you'll hear more about them tomorrow. So now it is my great privilege to introduce tonight's baccalaureate keynote speaker, Rick Caruso. For more than 40 years, he's been giving back to the Trojan family, including more than 15 years of service on our board of trustees and 4 years as chair. At his core, Rick is a man of faith. He's grounded by his family and his friends and his sweet dog, Hudson. I'm a little surprised you didn't bring him with you here tonight. Born in Los Angeles, Rick is the grandson of Italian immigrants and the son of a World War II veteran. Like his father, Rick also went to USC, and now he's the father of 4 Trojans. He studied business administration at the Marshall School, and he graduated with honors in 1980. Then he went on to Pepperdine Law School, and after a short stint in a law firm, he decided that he wanted to return to his passions, building and creating. He founded Caruso, the real estate company behind the creation of places like The Grove, Americana, Palisades Village. But with a nod to simpler times, Rick had a real vision with these buildings that he wanted to build places that were clean, they were safe, they were spaces where people could enjoy themselves, unwind, take a stroll. And they are beautiful, welcoming places. And he invites people to come there, and they don't even have to buy anything. Even while he was young and he was building his business from the ground up, he followed his grandmother's mantra, give back to your community. He certainly honored her wish. In 2006, Rick and his family were the driving force and the lead benefactors for the USC Caruso Catholic Center. It opened in 2012 and has since become one of the largest communities of Catholic students west of the Mississippi. In 2015, Rick and his family gave a game-changing gift to the Keck School Medicine's Department of Otolaryngology. Now that department is ranked in the top 10 of NIH research funding in the nation. Just a few weeks ago, he was awarded the university's highest honor, the Presidential Medallion. But for me, what actually distinguishes Rick as a Trojan is the time he spent as the USC board chair, leading the university through a very tumultuous time. But he was always challenging people, do better, prioritize our students, do the right thing. He committed himself to putting us on a path we're on today, and he has been an advocate, a friend. He's always leaning in and stepping up. I don't think I've ever seen him not smile a greeting when you see him. No matter what I or his alma mater ask for him, he says yes. Rick says, there is a positive energy that comes out of being surrounded by people you love and enjoy being with that. And he calls that his fuel. People have also told me that Rick has helped them find their own way back to their faith. Now, he doesn't do this by pushing his own personal faith, but rather by helping people see the beautiful, rich value in all faiths. And that's the message for tonight. Please join me in welcoming Rick Caruso.
Thank you, Carol. Incredibly generous and kind. I'm appreciative and I'm humbled. Before I get into my remarks, I would like to say the last 4 years with Carol in the lead of this university has been a remarkable journey. And as much as we talk about it, and the great words of the dean explaining all the changes that Carol has made to this university, it's really impossible to know the depth of the changes that she has made, especially given what she was inherited. I have been around a lot of great leaders. I've been blessed, whether it's in business or academia, whatever the case is. I have never met anybody quite like Carol Folt, nor a better leader. So Carol, thank you for your great leadership to this university. I'd like to congratulate all the graduates. It's an honor and a privilege to share this evening with you. No greater honor has actually come to me other than being invited to speak at this ceremony. And if I can, I want to speak on behalf of all the parents and the grandparents that are in the room tonight. I know that you feel your hearts are full. You're incredibly proud of all of these graduates. You grads actually make parenthood seem like a very good idea. And your parents are prouder of you than you will ever know. Tomorrow, you are graduating from one of the world's great universities. Mark this moment. You made it. A lot of late nights, too much coffee, roommates with no boundaries. Obviously, a lot has happened these past few years. Some very turbulent times. You passed all the tests. The real world now awaits you with semi-open arms. But I promise your USC education will serve you well. It will help you through even more turbulent times. As Carol referenced my immigrant grandmother, she used to always tell me and my siblings, "Rick, life is tough, but it's tougher if you're stupid." Should have met my grandmother. She was about this tall. With a degree in hand, you will never need to worry about being smart because you have received one of the finest educations a mind can be given. Now, as you know, the baccalaureate ceremony is unlike commencement tomorrow. It's about something more transcendental and spiritual. I take this tradition seriously, and if you don't mind, I will close with a prayer for you. So to begin with, I want to tell you three short and very, very personal stories that, frankly, I don't talk much about, if at all. They have nothing to do with GPAs or educational accomplishments. They deal with, instead, the less credentialed way to look at life, at faith, and success. These are stories from my life and about people I know and love. And then I want to tell you a fourth story. Whoa, whoa, whoa. That's okay. What do you want to bet she didn't vote for me? Thank you. Thank you very much. I should stop now. I'm ahead of the game. The first story is about my father, who was sent to jail when I was 14 months old. When I was running for mayor, the LA Times did a front page story, and in the article was a photo of the newspaper reporting his conviction in the early 1950s. My father and I never spoke of it. At the time, it was huge news, and the big headline on the front page read, "Caruso fined $10,000, given a year's jail term." At the time, my father was well known as one of the largest car dealers in the world, selling more than 1,000 cars a month. When he was indicted, he lost his dealerships and he lost his fortune. I was 14 months old and too young to remember him going to jail. But that fact was made known to me in first grade when some kids at school taunted me and yelled out, "Your dad's been in jail. He's a crook." My father was my idol, my best friend. It hurt so much that I ran into the corner of the boys' bathroom and cried. I remember it like yesterday. My first grade teacher, Sister Editha, a large woman in an old-fashioned nun's habit, comforted me. She folded me into that big habit and held me close. It was as if she was trying to press me into all of that peace and love of her comforting faith. I will never forget it. I felt embarrassed and hurt. My father, I'm sure, felt great shame. He was the son of two Italian immigrants who had nothing of worth except their faith, their family, and their belief in this country. And actually, that's quite a bit. And they expected their children to do the right thing and be grateful that they were in America, a land with endless opportunity. My father's situation was counter to what my grandparents would have expected from their children. My father had close friends, but after being in jail, he withdrew socially. I'm sure that's why he was always against me running for office. I also know why he wanted me to go to law school. He said he didn't realize what was going on, didn't understand it, had bad advisors. He wanted me to go to law school to protect myself. And in truth, I went more for him than for me. Yet 5 years after my father got out of jail, he opened a car rental business, had 18 Volkswagen Beetles, if you remember those. Then he opened a few more locations, and then was opening franchises around the country and around the world. You may have heard of that company called Dollar Rent-A-Car. It became one of the largest car rental companies in the world. The reason I tell you my father's story is because it's about resilience, of rising above shame, rising above failure, and rising above loss. He withstood it all, came back after being knocked down, and lost his wealth and his reputation. My father did not have a diploma, but he did have courage. He had courage the way LA has sunshine. The second story I want to tell you is about my daughter, Gianna, who graduated from USC last year. The year Gianna was born, a law went into effect requiring babies to be tested at birth for hearing. The day after she was born, we learned that she had severe hearing loss. We felt the rush of joy at having a daughter, and then the rush of worry and pain, wondering how this disability might affect this little life that we held in our arms. We immediately went to experts to get her tested. She had permanent hearing loss. She was given hearing aids at 6 months old. As a child, she felt the social stigma of walking into a classroom wearing hearing aids. I think we can all imagine that as a child. She was embarrassed. The hearing aids made her feel different from other children. She felt like everyone was looking at her. It was harder to make friends, and many times she didn't want to go to class. Little things others take for granted are difficult, like sleepovers. For her friends, the fun started when the lights went out and the parents went to bed. But for Gianna, that's when the fun ended. She felt isolated and alone because she couldn't read lips anymore. She felt disconnected, and there were difficulties in class. She had trouble hearing teachers and couldn't read lips when they worked on the blackboard. It is mentally exhausting, we learned, to read lips and remain alert in class and understand what's happening around you. She would come home and fall asleep. We finally got her some help, but the big help was a new technology, an advancement that hearing aids went deep into the ear canal, basically invisible, up right against the eardrum. The minute the USC audiologist inserted them, Gianna's eyes lit up. Gianna heard sounds she had never heard before. That night we were at home and Gianna said, "Mom, Dad, it's raining." And I said, "Yes, it is, it's raining." And she said, "No, Dad, I hear the rain." And then it clicked. I understood. That was the first time she heard raindrops. Gianna says that in many ways, her hearing loss provided her a different kind of gift. We talked about it again last night. It taught her resilience. It taught her to trust that she could adjust to new and difficult circumstances. Gianna has resilience the way LA has nice, shiny cars, in abundance. Gianna has put her disability to work for others. She holds festivals for children and their parents who are deaf. I sat with one father who just started crying. I totally understood. Gianna's story is a story of a child who persevered. Although she has a degree from USC, years before she earned a degree in rising above. Now, the third story comes from my own experience. 6 months ago today, I was elated. I thought I had been elected mayor. The election returns were still being counted, but even a week after Election Day, I thought I had won. At the campaign, we were making plans for a transition and the inauguration, and then it flipped, and I had lost. Now, at first, I sort of accepted it. I was telling people, if I lost, how come I feel so good? And that was true. I did feel good because the campaign was invigorating and challenging and rewarding in so many ways. But then, amidst this glow of good feeling, I became disappointed and saddened. I don't know whether I was depressed, but I didn't have the same energy for a while. For a couple months, it was tough. I had felt disappointment in my life, but not to that degree. And then, I began to put into perspective what had happened in my life over the course of the campaign. I regained my equilibrium back because I began to appreciate the depth of the experience I had been through and the people I had come to know. One woman in particular I got to know and has become a dear friend, and I speak of her often, is LaWanda Hawkins. When LaWanda lost her child to gang violence in South LA, she founded an organization called, and get this name, Justice for Murdered Children. She took her pain, she took her heartache, she took her devastation, and she rose above. Her endorsement meant so much to me. She's an angel to the city of Los Angeles. Every Thanksgiving, she gives away dinners to hundreds of people in her community who have been affected somehow by gang violence. But guess what happened after she endorsed me? The city cut off her funding and cut off the support for the dinners. How petty, how morally corrupt. So Tina and I donated the 400 dinners and went down to help. LaWanda is what I love about politics, and how she was treated is what I hate about politics. Her resilience does not come from a diploma, and the resilience of the other mothers who've lost children doesn't come from a diploma. LaWanda has resilience. She has courage. She has heart, just the way the Trojans now have touchdowns. Now, finally, my last story, and it's about all of you in this great class. I see a resilience in you, and it is why I feel, too, that I have a special bond with this class. Your resilience goes beyond the fact that your years were marked by COVID epidemic, which disrupted your academic and social life. It was a remarkable burden, the hardship of which we are still learning. But there's something else. Most of you came here when USC's downward spiral of betrayal and corruption was coming to light. This was also the period when I was asked to become chair of the Board of Trustees, which is why I will always think of you as my class. This university was going through the most turbulent, most divisive time in its history. The comments online doubted the very integrity of the school that we love. Some said that the university was morally corrupt or morally bankrupt. The university was called a dishonest institution. I can tell you how many hours I spent going around listening to students and faculty, one student after another, feeling that the university had failed them. But here's the thing that's truly important, that I will never forget. You came to USC in spite of the scandals that were breaking. You believed in the core of USC was worth saving. You gave this university a chance to right itself, to prove itself, to reassert the values on which it had been founded. You believed in the resilience of USC. You had faith in us, and you had faith in your own ability to rise above the turmoil that had befallen this campus. And as chairman, and I know from my fellow trustees, we felt a true responsibility to live up to your trust. I know the resilience you have displayed through COVID and through the university crisis will serve you in the years ahead. I hope it gives you confidence. In fact, at commencement tomorrow, I wish I could stamp on your diplomas a red wax, a seal of resiliency for each of you, because you have shown it. And with your resiliency, I pray that you do not shy away from taking the high road, from taking enough risks, from seeking enough challenges. Now, I mention a prayer because I think it's obviously so appropriate at your baccalaureate. So I'd like to read a passage from one of my favorites. Disturb us, Lord, when we are too pleased with ourselves, when our dreams have come true, because we have dreamed too little, when we have arrived safely, because we have sailed too close to shore. Disturb us, Lord, to dare more boldly, to venture on wilder seas, where storms show your mastery, where losing sight of land, we shall find the stars. But as you pursue your individual paths and venture boldly and find the stars, I pray that you help others to be resilient and rise above. When you see someone in need, I pray that you lend a hand. When you find someone who is getting down, I pray that you lift them up. When you help someone lead a better life, you are creating a better world. The people that I admire the most are the ones that give back and are glad for it, who remember where they came from and how much they owe to others. As Trojans, you will soar. You will be laser-focused on obtaining your goals with speed and precision. But no matter how high you soar or how fast your life moves, pause, reach back, and bring somebody along. Everyone in this audience can remember a time when somebody did us a good turn, or maybe just gave us a break when it really mattered. To bring this to close, I would like to add a final thought. You are here today because something called you to be here, something unspoken that could not be met at tomorrow's commencement. The spiritual, call it faith or whatever you want to call it, it has always given me resiliency. When I let it, it has given me the same feeling as Sister Editha holding me close. It has given me comfort. It has given me strength. It has provided the arms to hold me. It is beyond the credentials of a degree. I pray daily, and today I pray for you. As you set out on your journey tomorrow, proudly with your degree in hand, I pray that you do not suffer the hardships of my father, my daughter Gianna, or LaWanda. But if you do, I pray that you may find yourselves their resilience in your life, their strength, and their means of rising above, which would otherwise hold you down. And I pray that in your lives you may find the love, the peace, and the comfort of Sister Editha. Thank you very much.
I greet you all with Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace and blessings be upon all of you, faculty, alumni, students, parents, and fellow graduates. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Alhamdulillah. I start by praising God for allowing me to be here this evening, celebrating the class of 2023. Graduates, my goodness, we absolutely did it. What an incredible honor it is to be speaking and standing here tonight at this beautiful baccalaureate celebration. An evening that honors students for braving an all-encompassing personal journey at USC. Tonight, I'd like to share and reflect on the concept of storytelling. Storytelling is pervasive through life. Much information is captured and stored in the form of stories, and we've heard some stories tonight already. Although lectures, as students we might all know, tend to put us to sleep, stories move us to action, letting us learn real, valuable life lessons. Yet, sometimes we get so caught up in making sure that every single story is written so perfectly. With no room for error, as if you're writing it for somebody else. Why? Stories make you who you are, but nobody should change your story for others. My USC chapter here echoed this very narrative. I learned that the collection of everything I have experienced here has indeed confirmed that I don't need to change my story for anybody else. Those around me may add to my story, morphing into important side characters, but I am my own main character. Class of 2023, you are your own main character. Remember that. So I'd like to ask all of you a rhetorical but reflective question. What is your story? And how has USC played a role in this chapter in your life? I'm not a professor, so don't worry. I'm not asking anybody to do assigned readings, annotate 25-page written articles, or even write a 10-page paper. But what I will encourage tonight is some personal introspection in understanding who you used to be, who you are today in this very moment, and who you want to become in the years ahead. Leading up to this evening, I've reflected quite a lot. You know, what my USC journey is, what it means to me, and my own story. Truthfully, it's been a beautiful mess. Yeah, it's funny, but you know. I'll spare you guys the details, and instead I'll just share a moment in time that encapsulates my entire college chapter. So let me paint a picture. It's 2 a.m, you're dizzy, confused, and have just woken up in some random middle of nowhere hospital in Big Bear. You know, humor me a little bit. Wires everywhere hooked up onto your body. You can hear the beats from the monitors pulsating. Your anxiety isn't helping. You can't see clearly because your vision is impaired from the tears on your own face. And all you can hear is that sound. The sound gets louder and louder on the monitors until a nurse runs in just as your eyes close shut again. That was me. In the early hours this past President's Day weekend when I was attending the first ever Muslim Student Union retreat, a 3-day retreat I helped plan as the president of the student organization. We immersed ourselves in the outdoors, a packed itinerary filled with sports, religious reflection, and games. But on the last night of retreat, I decided to play soccer. I was playing soccer with some Muslim Student Union members, and the game was cut short when I was elbowed in the back of my head. That was my father in the con. Yeah. From there, the details get fuzzy. My friends did everything I told them not to do while I was kind of out of it. One, they rushed me to the hospital. And two, they called my parents. In hindsight, they did everything they were supposed to do correctly. Trust me, I verified, I asked the doctor if they were overreacting, and he said they weren't. Thankfully, my EKG and CT scan came back clear, but the doctor diagnosed me with a concussion. It was my third head injury in less than 3 weeks. The symptoms were mentally, physically, and emotionally draining. Between the nausea episodes and the migraines, I could barely look at a screen, never mind lead an organization of over 200 members and still keep up with rigorous academic classes. For the first time, my life felt like it was on pause. And on top of this, my world around me was crumbling. I couldn't function the way I used to. Sleepless nights, but also nights where I'd cry myself to sleep. So now what? I wondered. And to answer my own question, I recall the following verses from the 94th chapter of the Holy Quran. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا So surely with hardship comes ease. Surely with that hardship comes more ease. Ease. It was something I was so desperately attaining for after riding turbulent waves. I've never been good at asking for help, but God knew in that very instant I needed it the most. He promised me ease, that my soul would not be burdened beyond its capacity. And indeed, his promise came true. I found this ease through the Muslim Student Union at USC. My leadership team stepped up and filled in for me when I was out of office recovering. I still vividly recall a board member telling me a short few words. We got you, but you have to help us by helping yourself first. The community that started with just 20 members in my freshman year grew to nearly 200 in the last few days of my presidency. A community that provided comfort and ease to any person who joined. The support was there, even when I couldn't muster up the courage to ask for it. I found this ease with empathetic professors who granted me extensions and papers without hesitation. One Ann Arbor professor expressed that she wanted to see me in full health, that she was on my team, that she was there for me if I needed any further accommodations. That's a student's dream, to know that the person there guiding you through these years is actually looking out for you. I found this needed ease in my LA apartment home through my housemates and my OC home through my parents. My roomies, one of them up there right there, doing grocery shopping for me, and my parents refilling my medications and driving me to appointments. I realized I wasn't alone in my recovery. It took a whole village, and I couldn't be more grateful for the community that I built and found at USC. You know I could have written this plot a little bit differently, narrated it with different events that occurred, glamorizing recovery the way books and movies like to do. That, you know, it only took a short few days, downed a bunch of Tylenol, and that I was back at 100%. But this is far from the truth. And I don't intend to change that chapter. Instead, I choose to live my story authentically. Recovering from my concussion, or concussions, because yes, I've suffered from more than one this year, retaught me one of the greatest life lessons I've learned thus far. Trust and patience. Those are the two most powerful defense mechanisms in navigating adversity. Overcoming setbacks wasn't new to my USC chapter, having faced several challenges along the way. But in hindsight, I've realized this newfound lesson, trust and patience and practicing them, was what I was missing in championing through previous obstacles. We've all faced hardships. It's a facet of human existence, but our perseverance and our determination to overcome them makes you resilient. And you've already heard this, guys, but class of 2023, do you understand just how resilient you are? Truly, we face a global pandemic, yet we fostered connections. We struggled through uncertainty, but left stronger being comfortable in being uncomfortable. We encountered challenges, setbacks, doubt towards our worldviews. However, we have embraced our identities confidently. Graduates, what's your next chapter in this crazy thing we call life? How do you plan to live and write it? I pray that it is filled with love, joy, and growth. And as you leave USC, I hope you feel empowered, knowing that your story will live on, being heard by those around you if you only choose to share. Gratitude and appreciation are a prophetic trait, so I'd like to conclude shortly by thanking each and every single person here for showing up tonight and for consistently showing up in the lives of those graduating. Thank you, President Foltz and the Office of Religious Life, for cultivating an environment of belonging, welcoming diverse storytelling as shown through all parts of USC. On behalf of the graduating class, I especially want to express from the bottom of my heart a huge, huge thank you to all of our support systems here tonight, beloved family and friends. Those here tonight, those watching online, those abroad, those who have passed away, thank you for being integral characters in our life, influencing us to be who we are today. Y'all inspire us to be our best selves. Muslim Student Union members in the audience tonight, I know who you guys are. I want to give you a personal shout out. Thank you for being a home away from home. I wouldn't trade it for the world. The cluster of memories I have made here has added to my own understandings of who I am in various ways. So thank you for providing me with the acceptance, understanding, and empathy I craved when I started college. To my family, Abba, Mama, Abi, Safia, Layla, Rumbai, Sumerica, everybody, thank you. There are no words to describe how grateful I am to have had your unconditional support and love these past few years. If you could take all the words in the dictionary, it still wouldn't describe just how much I love you guys. To fellow graduates, congratulations. And may this new chapter in your life be filled with blessings. All the hard work, effort, and love you put into writing this chapter and embracing your stories as the years unfold ahead doesn't go unnoticed. Whatever it may be, I truly hope it's been eye-opening. Perhaps it's the people you've met along the way that have become forever characters in your life. The religious and spiritual journey you've encountered, and for me, the late night boba runs and the University Religious Center all-nighters, I hope you hold on to it. Reflecting that everything that happens, happens for a reason, despite us not understanding why. Whilst our story is not over yet, our chapter at USC closes. Thank you for granting me the opportunity to share bits and pieces of mine. Class of 2023, you and your story are worthy of being shared. So share it confidently, embracing it to your fullest potential. I hope you never forget that. Here's to finding people who accept us wholeheartedly and love us unconditionally. Here's to creating everlasting memories. And here's to being present tonight. Congratulations, and fight on forever and always.
Let's hear it again for Aisha Patel. Thank you, Aisha, for sharing your profound scholarly and spiritual journey with us this evening. I'm so glad that your family is here to celebrate Baccalaureate with us as well. Fun fact, Aisha's mother, Dr. Nabila Patel, is a longtime professor of medicine and attending physician in the Department of Pediatrics at the Keck School of Medicine here at USC. And my wife's mentor and favorite professor when she was a medical resident here in pediatrics. So, Nabila, heartfelt congratulations to you on this wonderful moment from my family to yours. No doubt that this is truly an inspiring full circle Trojan story for all of us. Aisha graduates tomorrow from the USC Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism with a major in communication, a minor in business, and a perfect 4.0 GPA, which is no easy feat, especially given how involved she was as a campus leader of student organizations. Not only did she serve as the president of the Muslim Student Union this year, she was also a columnist and editor for The Daily Trojan, a multimedia journalist for Annenberg News, and the marketing director for the USC Photo Club. In my conversations with Aisha, I learned that the reason she is so deeply invested in student leadership is because she cares so much about her fellow students. In so many ways, she models a core truth for all of us that we all have the opportunity and the responsibility to be leaders in the way that we live our lives. Aisha shows us how we can all lead by example, by leading with integrity, by leading with courage, and by leading with love. Lucky for us, Aisha will return to USC in the fall to complete her master's degree in communication management at the Annenberg School, so we don't have to say goodbye just yet. Upon completion of her graduate degree, Aisha will continue to work closely with companies like General Motors, HBO Max, and Uber to help them leverage their digital storytelling opportunities. As she goes out into the world as a creative marketing executive, she will take the hopes, dreams, and aspirations of all of you with her, as will each and every one of you. And now, for my favorite part of the evening, my favorite part of the year, I ask all graduating students to please rise. Let's hear it for the new graduates of the University of Southern California. Please remain standing. You've earned this moment. We've all earned this moment. I'm not crying, you're crying. President Folt, I present to you your graduating class of 2023. To the new graduates of the University of Southern California, you embody the best of your generation, the most multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-religious, multinational, multilingual, multidisciplinary, multi-hyphenated generation in human history. You are technologically savvy, intellectually curious, spiritually evolved, globally connected, civically engaged, socially conscious, politically astute, hopeful and resilient, and wise beyond your years. You're innovative and creative, positive about the future, ready to tell new stories and prepared to solve new problems. As you walk your path with passion and purpose, and as you find your place and way in a rapidly changing world, may you embrace the words of the great American theologian and civil rights leader, Howard Thurman, who said, "Don't ask what the world needs. Ask what makes you come alive and go do it. Because what the world needs is people who have come alive." To our graduating students, as you embark upon your exciting new journey and write the next chapter of your life story, may you go with peace and prosperity, May you go with blessing and inspiration. May you bear the palm and forever fight on, and may we all stay together. Amen. You may be seated. Well, folks, this formally concludes our annual baccalaureate ceremony. I'm so grateful to our keynote speakers. I'm so grateful to Rick Caruso, who's really the lifeblood of religious life here, epitomizes grace under pressure, and has done more for this university than anyone I know. Let's hear it for Rick. And I'm so grateful to our extraordinary student speaker, Aisha Patel. Let's hear it for Aisha. Let's hear it again for our inspiring, and I'm so appreciative for the soulful sounds and musical meditations of Aspen Jacobson and the USC Thornton Chamber Singer. Let's hear it one more time for our amazing student musicians and singers. I'm so thankful to all of you for joining us this evening for this spiritual celebration of commencement, especially the parents, grandparents, and siblings out there. Let's hear it for all of you. Give yourselves a hand. And most of all, I am so very, very proud of our graduating students who worked so hard under such difficult circumstances and who accomplished so much in order to earn their degrees here at USC. Let's hear it one more time for the new graduates of the University of Southern California. We have all eagerly waited 4 long years for this intimate moment of togetherness. Let's make sure we're fully present in this moment with ourselves and with each other. Let's not take any of this for granted. And let us remember that it is with love that we come, with love that we go, and with love that we shall remain with one another. Please enjoy the rest of your commencement activities, events, programs, and ceremonies. Please take good care of yourselves and each other. And please rise as you are able for the recessional and remain standing until the platform party is exited. Thank you again. Congratulations to the graduating class of 2023, and fight on, everyone.
Thank you for attending the 2023 Baccalaureate Ceremony. Please remain in your seats until the official party has exited the auditorium. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of your evening.